Cord. All right, we're gonna get started. Good evening, fifth grade parents. We wanna welcome you to our back to school night. I'm Jenny Einberger. I'm the fifth grade team leader. So I'm just gonna kick us off tonight, and then you'll get to hear from all of our teachers that we have on our team throughout the evening. And we just really appreciate you for coming and logging in and being here with us so that we can tell you a little bit about fifth grade so we can have a great year. And at the end of our presentation, we'll have an opportunity for some Q&A. So if you have a question now and you don't hear the answer to it throughout the presentation, please hold on to that and we would be happy to answer your questions at the end of our presentation. In addition to that, if something comes up in your mind that you have another wondering, please feel free to reach out to your child's advisor after tonight's presentation, and we'd be happy to talk further with you as the advisees to your student to help answer any questions that you might have. So I wanted to just sort of give you sort of the lay of the land of fifth grade in terms of the advisories and the gibushim. So we have three homerooms, which we call a gibush in middle school, and that is the BE gibush, and the letters are taken from the last name of the advisors that are the teachers in that classroom. So the BE gibush is the Ms. Bolte, Ms. Einberger gibush, and we're in room 404. The BW gibush is room 406 with Ms. Barak and Ms. Winter. And then we have the MS gibush, which is room 324 with Ms. Macbeth and Ms. Sherman. And then as those advisees of Ms. Sherman know, that she's on a current rotation with sixth graders. So Ms. Johnson, who is our rotation right now, which is PE, is stepping in as like the in-person advisor for this first quarter. And Ms. Johnson is going to take you through the rotation schedule for the year when it comes time for her to present about her PE curriculum as to when the kids are going to have visual arts and music and then another section of PE throughout the school year. So with that being said, since we share Ms. Sherman in this first quarter with sixth grade, we just wanted to make sure that all of our fifth grade parents know a little bit about her. So I'm going to toss it to Ms. Sherman to sort of introduce herself on a personal level. I think you're muted, Gilly.
All right. So hello, fifth grade parents. It's lovely to have you with us tonight. And just want to tell you that the Gibouche is something so wonderful at Bernard Zell. It's really a very special feature. And I love to think about also the word itself. It is a Hebrew word that means to sort of bring together, legabesh, to connect or to form community. And that's really what we do with the Gibouche time. It's kind of like we have a family within the school, and we have a wonderful structure for every morning with the morning meeting that gives the students a sense of grounding, a sense of belonging, and just a wonderful way to start off their day. And like I said, it's something very, I think, very unique to Bernard Zell and very special. I myself have a very strong connection to fifth grade in particular. I think it's because my memories of that age for myself are very, very strong. That is the age that I was when my family decided to move from the United States, my parents decided to move us from the United States to Israel. And because it was such a huge shift in my life, my memories of that time are very, very strong. And interestingly, in my class in Rehovot in fifth grade, we had something very similar to Gibouche. And I remember thinking, back then, when I was that age, that it was something that I didn't know at all from the United States, but it was very unique to Israel. And again, it was that idea of building community. We did it a little differently. It was a once a month meeting on Friday nights after Shabbat dinner. The students would all come together again. And so what I love about Bernard Zell is that we do it every morning. And then again, with that strong memory from my time in fifth grade, it does help me connect with the students in fifth grade for our Gibouche. And because I'm also an art teacher, the middle school art teacher at Bernard Zell, one of my aims is to try to connect as much art as possible into our Gibouche time. I like to try to weave that into the activities that we do. And at the same time, as an art teacher, I really see myself as being able to weave the things that we do in Gibouche into the art program. In Gibouche, we build community, kihilah. We talk a lot about social responsibility. I know that's been the theme for the year, achrayut. And we also even talk about leadership, manhigut, how each student can become a leader in his or her own way. And so bringing that from the Gibouche into the art program is very important to me. And at the same time, just to say a little bit about art, like to bring in a lot of playfulness. You know, we're sitting in front of screens for so many hours. And so I'm so glad that both in the morning meeting for the advisory and in art class, it's an opportunity where we can do a lot more that's tactile and hands-on. So that's just a little hint about the art program. When your students do have their art rotation, I will be sharing that information with you, much more about the art program. I'll be sending an email with, you know, full information about the program. But in the meantime, I just want to say that even though I am not physically in the classroom yet with the fifth graders, I want you to know that I feel that I am able to make a real connection with your students, and I'll be checking up with them one-on-one much more because I need to, because I am not physically in the classroom. All right, I will pass it over to Ms. Einberger. Thank you.
Thank you. So thank you, Ms. Sherman, and we look forward to having you actually teach the kiddos coming up in a little bit. I guess it's towards the end of the year.
Yes.
So I wanted to introduce myself again, like on a personal level, like Ms. Sherman just did. And then after I go, I'm going to pass it to Ms. Lev, who is part of the reading and writing team in fifth grade, so that she can introduce herself. And then we'll go through the reading and writing curriculum. So this is a little bit about me. This is my fifth year at Bernard Zell. It's also my fifth year teaching fifth grade reading and writing. And on the left-hand side here, I have some books that I really enjoyed this summer. So The Parker Inheritance is actually going to be one of the book club book choices. It's about a girl that's about fifth grade. I think she's 11 or 12 years old. And they kind of go on a mystery that takes place in the South, that's in modern day, but then goes back in time to the 60s during the civil rights movement. And she and her friend are both Black youth growing up in the South and are taken back in history to realize that discrimination has been going on for a long time and how it's affected their families personally, and how being Black has been a challenge, not just in their personal lives, but then in the broader sense in the United States. And it's just such a great book to teach those lessons to children. This book, Front Desk, is also going to be a book club choice here in our first unit. It's about a Chinese immigrant family who end up taking over as managers of a motel in California. And there were a lot of pieces about race and inequality in this text as well. So I wanted to be really intentional about the text choices that I give students right now, especially where we live in this time, and open up their minds to not just who they are, but who other people are, and making sure that we're really broadening their sense of immigrants. And this specifically takes place in modern times, and not only do we hear about the Chinese immigrant struggle, but we also hear about there's some residents at the motel who are mostly Black and what their struggles have been being American, living in the United States. And then finally, a book I read this summer. So this is Ibram X. Kendi's book, Stamped, but Jason Reynolds, who is one of my favorite Black young adult authors right now, he rewrote this book for kids. And my plan is not to necessarily introduce this whole book to fifth grade this year, but there are parts of it that I think we could really benefit from when we're in this first unit and also just throughout the year. It's funny, Jason Reynolds writes that he's like, this is not a history book, because I think it's his writing tells the Black story as a story, but takes slavery all the way back, to Europe, starting with white slaves, and through, to modern times. And so it's written in a way that kids can really understand why the world is, the way it is, specifically in the United States, because he brings it really home throughout the text, and, sort of teaches us this vocabulary of being anti-racist. And I really liked the way that Jason Reynolds wrote this for children that are middle school aged. So that's a little bit about my reading this year and what I'm gonna bring into the class. This picture in the middle, that's my family. That's my husband, Scott, and my two sons. This is Asher, he's in SK. And I mean, sorry, this is Eddie, he's in SK. And this is Asher, he is in nursery. Asher's a little rebel, so he takes up more of my attention. I think that's why I said his name first. So we're a Bernardsell family through and through. I'm a big tennis fan, I'm a tennis player. If you have any kids in the BE Gibouche, you might've heard that we watched a little bit of the Serena Williams match during lunch today. One benefit of eating lunch in the classroom, I guess. I like to run. I went to Indiana. I'm a big football fan. I'm from Indianapolis, so I'm unfortunately a Colts fan last year and this year, so we'll see how the season goes. And then I wanted to add this Seder plate. My mom actually made this out of fused glass years ago, and it's like one of the most special pieces of Judaic art I have. She's since passed away, so it really is then extra special. But she made two of these. My aunt has one, her sister, and then my dad still has this at his house, but I've claimed it for my own, because Passover is a really important holiday to me. It just reminds me of getting together at my bubby's with all my cousins, and having a really long Seder, staying up till 1 a.m. until we sing Chag Gadiah. And so it's just really special to me, and it's something that I really like about teaching here at BZ is, it's kind of gotten me, back into appreciating my Jewish heritage, and I think it's really helped my family really participate and practice more regularly. So with that, I'm going to hand it to Ms. Lev, who teaches with me in reading and writing.
I'm Hillary Lev. Thank you for that introduction, Jenny. And I'm sure many of you know me. I was the lower school specialist for SK through second grade for the past 6 years. And this year I have the privilege of being in middle school and working with fifth and sixth grade. So I'm very excited to be here and to be part of this fifth grade team. And as you can see here, I have some of my favorite books. Where the Crawdad Sings is one of my all-time favorites. Wonder, another wonderful story. Pachinko, another great book. Here you see my family. It's very hard to get a photo, a family photo, with all four of us looking in the same direction. So this is the most recent, as my son Mickey, who's 10 months, he changes every day, every week. So I wanted to have a most recent photo. My husband Jason and my daughter Mila, who is 3 and a half, and she is a rambunctious one. Yeah, she did not want to look. And you see too, here's some of my favorite things. I love to travel. I've had the privilege of going to some amazing spots. Journaling, I definitely write down everything these days, whether it's a feeling, an emotion, a grocery list, you know, just my to-do list. I feel like I'm writing everything down and putting post-its and notes everywhere I go, especially for my husband to remind him of things to do as well, since he's at home and I'm here. and of course, there is the Star of David. It's really nice to, like we had last Friday, to have the Shabbat and to have that at home with my children and to pass down some of these traditions that my husband and I have grown up with and to share it with my son and daughter. So that's really nice. And then please excuse the barbell and the kettlebell there, but fitness is another big part of my life. My sister owns a gym and I like to be a big support to her. So I try and do the best that I can. And so just as I said, I'm gonna give a quick view, background of what I'm doing. I'm reading and writing support, and I collaborate with Jenny. I do some team teaching. I'll also be in all the team planning meetings as well. And my support might be various small groups, individually outside of the classroom, or at times when I can't be in the classroom, it'll be via Google Meet or Zoom. So kids will get to see me that way. And it's nice too, because these kids know me from first and second grade. So thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Hillary. So just a little bit about the reading and writing workshop. So we do have a workshop model, which means that I'll have a mini lesson at the beginning of class. Then there'll be independent work time, which also will provide me some opportunity to conference with students individually, or you know, in groups or pairs. All of that workshop model, so that mini lesson, really includes a lot of things. So number one, read aloud. So we started our read aloud book this last week, called Home of the Brave. It's about a Sudanese refugee named Keck who comes to the United States alone from a refugee camp to live with his aunt and cousin. And we sort of don't know what happened to his mother. We know that his father and brother were killed and that he's coming to the United States on his own, even though he has his aunt and cousin. He calls his mother, father, and brother his truest family. So we talk a little bit about what that means in terms of immediate family. And that's where I do a lot of my demonstration and modeling my thinking aloud, so that students are then able to do the type of thinking, like the analytical thinking or processing thematically. They can do that then next with their own books or in book clubs. So we will start the year off in this unit with book clubs. So those will be forthcoming in the next week to week and a half. And so we right now are working on writing about our reading, which is really new for fifth graders. And then once we get that under our belt, we'll get into our book clubs. We'll also later in the year have a little bit of a debate, and there is some debate in the book clubs where a question I like to ask kids when they get further into their text, maybe around the second book, is, you know, something like, what do you think is the biggest challenge for your main character? And what's great is that the way young adult novels are written these days is, you know, there's so many things that happen to these kids. So we'll do that with Keck. We'll debate whether it's, you know, having to come to America is his biggest challenge. Having to be uprooted from his home and live in the refugee camp was his biggest challenge. Perhaps there's some things that happen in the United States that are his biggest challenge in life. And it really gets kids thinking and finding that evidence to prove their claim. And finally, in writing, we really take them through the writing process. So from the planning stage all the way through to the editing stage and everywhere in between. So tomorrow we're actually gonna be starting with our personal narrative. So that takes us also to our next slide. These are our units. And so tomorrow we're gonna be starting to generate ideas for personal narratives. So I'm gonna, actually, you can do this at home if you wanna have a conversation with students tonight or tomorrow morning before school, to think of turning points in their lives. We think turning points can help kids think of really great personal narratives. So maybe the first time they did something, the last time they did something, or I like to give them the time that they realized something. So something, some time that you learned something. I remember when I was in my 20s, I learned that I really liked my parents as people. And I remember talking to my cousin about that. And I said, you know, I felt so fortunate. And I've written a personal narrative about that as a model for the kids. But you know, you grow up with your parents as parents and you respect them and listen to them. But then I remember as an adult, like I'm lucky I had people that I really liked, like I would hang out with them. And so that's like a time I realized something. And that's an example I like to give because it's something we don't think about as kids, I think. And I sort of like to plant that seed now. And hopefully they can have that realization a little bit earlier than I did. But I really enjoy teaching this age. We have a lot of fun. I think we grow a lot. I talk about a reading growth spurt, a writing growth spurt. And so you'll look for that this year. So thanks for listening. Thanks for being here with us. And I'm going to pass it off to Ms. Macbeth.
Thanks so much, Jenny. So hi, everybody. I'm Deanna Macbeth. Some of you know me already. I teach fifth grade science here at Bernard Zell. This is my 15th year at the school, and it's my 10th year of teaching science, or 11th. I am also a parent here at the school. My child Bonnie is in first grade, so I get to see both sides of the coin, and I couldn't be more proud of the school and everything that we've accomplished over the last 15 years and in the last 15 days. So kudos to all of us. A little bit about me and my background. So I was born in Kentucky to like five generations in the ground of Kentucky folk, and I busted out my Kentucky accent to share with the students today because that really, they just get a big kick out of it. But I definitely grew up among the horse farms. Then suddenly in the middle of my fifth grade year, my family just randomly moved to Costa Rica. I mean, it's a long story. It had to do with family connections in South America, but January of my fifth grade year, we moved to Costa Rica. So then I spent middle and high school growing up in Costa Rica at an international school. The pictures there you can see are from my time there. That's really where I fell in love with science. I'm a polymath. I mean, I love kind of everything. I've taught all the general studies subjects here at Bernard Zell, but science is really my passion. It's what I sort of turn on for. And Costa Rica really brought that out in me in so many ways. All of the rainforests everywhere and the rain, you know, bright green and bright blue frogs and exploding volcanoes. That picture of the volcano there is where I went on my eighth grade overnight field trip, and they woke us up at 3 a.m. to come out and see it doing that, what it's doing in that picture. So I just fell in love with science. After I graduated there, I went to college in New Haven at Yale University, and then I moved to New York where I was an actress for a while, and then I started grad school and became a teacher. I taught briefly at the Heschel School in Manhattan, and then I came here to Chicago in 2005. I converted to Judaism here at Anshi Emet in 2008, and then I met my husband on Kol Nidre at Services in the Red Gym, and here we are, and there's Bonnie, and my stepdaughter Celeste is in the photo as well. So I'm really proud to be a part of Bernard Zell. Let's see, next slide. Jenny, can you advance? Oh, thank you. So science in fifth grade is, I really follow a constructionist philosophy, which is similar to constructivism, but it takes it a step further into constructionism. So constructivism is sort of an outgrowth of the philosophy of Piaget, that students have to, you know, construct their own understandings. They have to experience the learning, you know, firsthand in order to really come to a comprehension of what they're, you know, of what they're experiencing. And constructionism takes it the step of like, actually building things and using your hands to make things makes that all the better. So I do a lot of that in my classroom in a lot of ways. Fifth grade science takes a lot of different directions. We do some pure science, experimental design sorts of things, dissections, you know, just gathering data and looking at it and seeing what does that tell us, generating questions. I spent a lot of time on helping kids generate questions and making claims based on evidence that they gather. We also do engineering and we build things. And we also do computer science and we code things. So it's a lot of different things. Next slide. Some of the things I'm fascinated by, some of the recent books I've been reading. So Invent to Learn, Gary Stager is sort of the inheritor of Piaget philosophy through, Seymour Papert, who was the one who came up with Logo, he helped found Logo, which is a computer science language for children in the 80s. He wrote Mindstorms, which now Lego, if you've heard of Lego EV3 robots, Mindstorms is named after that. And his whole idea is that, you know, kids have to make things in order to learn. So that's where that constructionism comes in. I'm an anthropology major, so all the history of humankind and what makes us human and what that matters to us is super important to me. But I also really like to think about the future and like where life is going after us. I also am the school's resident puberty educator, so I'm constantly trying to keep up on the latest research about how the best way to teach that. Next slide. I bring this into my classroom by asking students, what do you want to make? Who are we as animals and as humans? And like, where are we going as a species? How has Earth changed over time and how will it still change? And it'll happen later in the year that we get to human growth and development, but I help kids deal with the concept of, you know, their bodies are changing and their lives are changing and how are they gonna handle it? Next slide. So I hinted at this, but the major units of study are life over time, which is evolution and biodiversity. We sort of study like everything from microorganisms. So we grow like fungus and bacteria on sterile micro paddles. We're planting jade plants that they'll be bringing home with them soon. And then we get into some invention and coding, and I'm going to be introducing them to microcontrollers. So you can see on the slide the microbit. This is a codable microcontroller that's sort of like a little portable computer. And we'll be coding it with Microsoft MakeCode, which is a block-based programming language similar to Scratch. And then it'll be later in the year that we get to human growth and development in May, but I will have them building hands-on models of the male and female reproductive systems and talking about some other topics as well. So I'm looking forward to this year with your kids. I love them already. And passing off to Ms. Bolte.
All right, I will be doing none of the reproductive talk in math class, but a lot of similar philosophies to Ms. Macbeth as far as having students construct their own understanding, which we'll get into. This is a little bit about me. I also grew up in Indiana. I'm from Columbus, Indiana. My wife, Kate, is the head women's basketball coach at Loyola, Chicago. So that's an interesting job for her to have, and a lot of stress with that. I played college basketball at Ball State. She actually played college basketball as well. We actually played against each other before we even knew each other. So it's kind of a funny story. I have a daughter who was born at the end of the year before last. She's 15 months old. Her name is Reese, and she happens to have Down syndrome. It has introduced us to a whole new wonderful community, much like how the Bernard Zell community is warm and loving and accepting of a lot of different people. The Down syndrome community we have found is another strong community that we just happen to find ourselves in. So she's a pleasure. If you know anyone who has Down syndrome or if you're involved in any organization like theirs, you know the joy of that. So, my personal philosophy, like I said, with math, we do a lot of constructing our own thinking. But to me, your attitude and effort, your growth mindset, those things are qualities that people can't do for you. I can inspire only to a point, but your attitude towards the subject and the effort you put into that has a lot to do with how far you can go. So I really kind of cheerlead and push, confidence build, and try to get kids believing that they can do it, even if math hasn't been a huge success for them to this point. Sometimes middle school looks a lot different for kids. And something I've really enjoyed in my transition to middle school, I come in from a high school background, is this is such an important age for learners. So much can turn for them. And even if the history with math, like I said, hasn't been maybe a love or a passion, sometimes in middle school that kind of lights up. And as your brain grows and changes, your understanding can too. So to keep an open mindset and think forward with that, we really push in our math department thinking over just answering, like, what was your process? We'll talk about that in class discussions. I'll ask kids, how did you think about that problem? What was your process? And we do a lot of building on ideas. So listening to other people's process and then building on top of that. And sometimes the best ideas come from combinations of two or more. And then I think practice and confidence can carry you a lot further in math. I think confidence sometimes comes from that practice, which to me is very important. Some of the big concepts that we cover in fifth grade have to do with fluency in multiplication and division. They've been exposed to multiplication and division. We try to push a few more strategies, get them more efficient, and start to push towards bigger processes where they're going to use that multiplication and division, and hopefully it becomes more automatic. Right now, we're beginning into our first unit with primes, composites, factors, multiples. Those, what numbers are parts of, is really important. And then we start talking about actual parts of numbers. So breaking it down into fractions, decimals, percents, and really creating an understanding of those things and not a procedure. We really push like understanding how big a number is, why when you add fractions, like the conceptual part of that, more than just here's how you do it. So we spend a lot of time at that conceptual level, and we found a lot more success for our students in the higher grades when they do have that solid conceptual understanding. There's units on measurement and conversion, along with some geometry concepts, area, perimeter, and volume. And then at the end of fifth grade, we're usually touching into some of the seeds of algebra, really more of a pre-algebra look at that, but really bringing in variables and talking about some of the patterns we're seeing and really start that algebraic thinking towards the end of the year, which is pretty developmentally appropriate. Everybody asks about homework, at least the kids do. It's really important to me that they have a time to engage with the mathematics independently. I design homework to be something that I believe that they can do and enter. We like to use the word good struggle. It should be challenging, but not to the point of tears or frustration. I appreciate parent support at home. Our partnership is crucial for kids' success. But I do like for them to attempt things on their own. I think practicing at home is good, and if they're extra practice, mom, dad, or whoever, that's always awesome. More the better for me, but I do like that time for them to be independent. Since we do, and historically have done a lot of group work in class, that's their chance for that. It's okay to make mistakes. I really encourage it. I think that's how we learn and how we grow. But that homework at home, like I said, it shouldn't be the struggle. It should be a good struggle. So not overly challenging, and I'm pushing 20 focused minutes. That's not like watching YouTube and then doing a little bit more. It's actually spending 20 minutes on the work and then moving on. And however far you get in that 20 minutes, if they have more time, if they're not frustrated, great. if we're there and it's done and it's time to move on, great too. I always say there's no homework emergencies. If it is tears and not a good experience, I don't want that either. So an email to me, encourage your child to email me and say, you know, I worked as long as I could. I was stuck on this one. We will always go over stuff the next day. And I'm always encouraging them to ask questions in class. So I'm happy to answer any questions that they have. Right. Like I said, communication, I think, is really crucial for families and myself to be on the same page and the student to be on the same page. Always those lines of communication, if they can stay open. If you have any further questions specific to math classes or to your child's progress, please reach out to me. I really appreciate your partnership in everything that we're doing this year. All right, I'll introduce Ms. Barak.
Hello. Hi, everyone. I am Ali Barak, and most of you probably already recognize me from the Shabbat Zoom that we did on Friday. Thank you, all of you, for joining us. I'm a Jewish study teacher and Hebrew teacher in fifth grade. This is my 11th year teaching in Brennan Zell and 17 years teaching in total. I have a bachelor degree in education, and my major was Jewish study. If you haven't already noticed from my accent, I was not born here. I was born in Israel. And when I moved first to the United States, I moved to Atlanta, Georgia, teaching also in a Jewish day school. Growing up in Israel, tradition and ritual was super important to my family. I always keep reminding my students that I come from a secular home, but even though I do come from a secular home, tradition was very important to my family. So on Shabbat dinner, every Friday, we had a Shabbat dinner. And even as a teenager, when I wanted to go out with my friends, my parents refused. They said, no, you're having a Shabbat dinner with us. Friday, it's a family time to hang out, have dinner, talk about the week, and do all the tradition that we're supposed to do. I love Chicago. And if the weather was better here 6 months of the year, I would probably would be number one city for me. But I don't like the winter so much. I'm from Israel. I also have a Brennan Zell family. My son go to fourth grade, as you can see here in the picture. And he love it, and I love it. All right, next slide. All right, so in my Jewish study class, we are focused on Jewish holiday, Chumash study, Tefillah, and Jewish vow. Right now we are learning about the month of Elul, focus on the important and meaning. We'll also focus on the Jewish value, Ve'egalat Elav, which in English means handing it down from generation to generation. After the high holiday, we'll begin learning Chumash Bereshit, which is Genesis, and we'll start with Parashat Toldot. In middle school, I like to say that we learn biblical texts on a deeper level. We start on a simple narrative, but quickly we move to a deeper thinker. We go into kind of like the shoes of the character, and we think about the motivation and the perspective of the character. At the beginning, I will invite them a reflection and deeper analysis by asking critical questions myself. But later on, I do expect for the student to ask questions and drive the discussion. We also bring the text alive by connecting it to their own personal life and also to the modern world. Next slide. In Hebrew, it's a little bit different this year because, as you might know, Hebrew and Jewish study are being taught at the same block. So I will look more for opportunity to link the two together. For example, right now, as I mentioned before, we are learning of the month of Elul. And the Malfa Velu tradition is centered around the idea of forgiveness. So we also learn in a story in Hebrew about how to say sorry and how to do it with a meaning. I structured this class to be challenging, but I also mindful the fact that we have different Hebrew learners in the same class. So I would try to keep every student comfortable, yet motivated. And of course, I will give enrichment for material for kids who really need it. To do that, I occasionally create different lesson plans to different groups of students in the same class. And it will base on how much they progress, and also the grouping might change through the year. That's about it. I am looking forward to have a successful and meaningful year learning together, no matter what it takes or where we are. And I will pass it to Ms. Winter.
Hi, My name's Claire Winter. I'm teaching history in fifth grade this year. I grew up with a really international look on life. You can see a family photo here. I was raised by my dad, who's Jewish, and my stepmom, who's from Thailand. She's from central Thailand in Ayutthaya, the old capital, if you've been there. The little lady sitting next to me in this photo. We grew up with Seder dinners and also annual monk, we call them monkathons. It's when the monks come and bless our house. So one thing that's really influenced me as a teacher is trying to get students to look at the world from a global perspective. I grew up in Evanston, which you can see here, and I also love to run along the lake. I went to the University of San Francisco and I studied history and education there. And after graduating, I moved abroad. I was supposed to move to Turkey on a government scholarship, but there was a coup, so I couldn't go. And I moved and I taught in Thailand. I always wanted to live there as an adult after growing up with Thai culture in my house. And I worked at a boarding school for a couple of years. And then I did end up moving to Istanbul and I taught English at a high school in central Istanbul. I put a couple books here I'm currently reading. As a history teacher, I think it's really important to also read nonfiction, which is why I'm reading Nixon Land. It's not because I love and worship Richard Nixon. It's more because with what's going on in America right now, we see a lot of comparison to that administration, and it's something I wanted to learn more about. I do suggest the book, although it's about 800 pages long, so I'm slowly going through it. And for fun, I'm currently rereading classics like Animal Farm, which I read when I was in middle school, and I don't think I understood a lot of it. So it's great to read it again. Can you go to the next slide? So in fifth grade history, it's really more like social studies as opposed to just history. So our first unit until December is the Jewish Court of All Time, which if any of you have older children who are in sixth or seventh or eighth grade, you might remember it from when they were in fifth grade. It's a Jewish issue, which is contemporary, which kind of fictional story is around this Jewish issue. And this year it's about religion in public spaces in France. Although today you can ask your kids, we were looking at photos of Native Americans in the US before assimilation programs and after assimilation programs. So a lot of what we're going to be working on for the first month is kind of understanding these concepts like assimilation, what is culture, things like that. And then we're going to go into, is clean water a human right? This is something that might seem kind of weird. I grew up here, you know, I could always turn on the tap and drink water, but for the last 4 years of my life, I haven't been able to do that. So that'll be something interesting that the kids will have to get used to. And they're going to be doing a lot of critical thinking and design thinking in the class. I apologize in advance, but I think it's really important to teach young adolescents how to build an argument and how to argue it from multiple sides, not just their own personal side, but someone else's. I understand that not every kid grows up going to rural Thailand, and not every kid descales a fish in a sink like I did. I think there's a lot of ways to learn about other people in a classroom, and I hope to make that more accessible through the history program this year. And I'm now going to pass it to Ms. Johnson.
Hello. So for those of you who don't know me, I am Ms. Johnson. I am new this year. And like I said earlier, I am our current rotations teacher. I am the PE teacher. So I am working with the fifth grade this year. A little bit about me. So on the left-hand side here, I have just put a map of China and a map of South Korea with Suzhou, China highlighted and Incheon, South Korea highlighted. For the better part of the last 8 years, I've been living abroad in 1 year in Korea and then 4.5 years in China. So that's had a lot to, had a big influence on me. I have Eat, Pray, Love there because that's my favorite book, kind of cliche, but it inspired me to move abroad. And then just a little bit about me through pictures. So for those of you who were on the Shabbat dinner on Friday night, you got to see my dog Addison. So here she is again. And then this is my main family, my parents, my brother, my sister-in-law, and then their three kids. So, and then a little bit about me. I teach PE. I'm very big into sports. There's not one particular sport that I do all the time. I kind of try new things all the time, learn different things. So my most recent sports that I've done and learned were Gaelic football, which is the national sport of Ireland. I did boxing when I was in China, and then I used to be a big runner. So those are my most recent ones. So next slide, please. So a little bit about the rotations. So with the fifth graders, they will go through 4 different rotations through the year. So they'll be in 9-week rotations. They're starting with me in PE. So that goes until October 30th. Then they'll rotate to music. Then they'll have another opportunity to be in PE. They won't be with me that time. They'll be with Mr. Sheehan, who's currently with the eighth grade students. And then they'll be finishing off with art with Ms. Sherman. So this year looks a little bit different for them. Typically they used to have PE or their rotation twice a week. This year they have it 4 classes a week and it's 55 minutes long. So it's a little bit longer. We're using 2 different gyms in the school. We're using both the blue gym and the red gym. And then with that, our program looks a little bit different. So they're going to be doing a lot of intentional physical fitness and wellness, and then focusing on physical skills, social skills, physical development, and wellness. So there's different parts that go into each of that and trying to get them, you know, to look at all different areas with that, within PE. So to the next slide, please. One of the larger challenges, but for PE was figuring out how to keep ourselves, the students, and the environment safe. So just to touch on that, to go over some things that we're doing, as you can see in this picture, you'll see orange boxes. And those are both in the blue gym and the red gym. So those are the students' kind of home base. So when they are not movement, when we're not doing a game or anything, that's their personal zone. So we call that their home base, and that's where they go. They're spaced 7 feet apart. So that's to give the kids their own space. We do a lot of warm-ups in those boxes. So a lot of fitness, a lot of wellness within those. When the students come into the gym, they all wash their hands. So they're coming into the gym with clean hands, and they're also washing their hands afterwards because they have been sharing some equipment, but we're just making sure that they're coming in with clean hands and leaving with clean hands, making sure to do that. We are minimizing the shared equipment this year, and then with all the equipment that we're using, we're sanitizing it as well. So just trying to take every measure that we can to keep the students, ourselves, the environment safe. So our units this year look a little bit different. We have a lot of individual fitness, so we might be doing some yoga, some high intensity interval training, conditioning, drum fit is a new one for us, some net games, doing some introductions to them. This week we've been doing traditional sports without the games, so showing them different drills and variations of the game they can do without, you know, actually playing the game, so teaching them how to do those things. So just a lot of different units and sports that they may be used to in years past. Softball, baseball, climbing, tumbling, track and field. So just different things this year for the students. So I think that's the last slide for PE. So I will throw it back to Ms. Einberger to finish us off.
All right, thank you guys so much. Sorry, we're just trying to figure out our audio here. So thank you to the teachers and parents for being here. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen here. And I think what would be best if parents, if you do have questions, to please add them in the chat. And I think we can take it from there. Does that sound good? Deanna, is that okay? Cool. So we'll just wait if you do have a question. If you don't have a question, I think, you know, you're free to head out, but if you want to stick around, please do so. One thing, teachers are really good at wait time. So when we ask a question, we're really good at just waiting for somebody to pipe in here. So, but feel free, if you don't have a question, log off. We'll just stick around for a few minutes. And then thank you again.
Anonymously too, if it goes in the chat, I mean, we'll just share it as a question. We won't sort of point you out.
Thank you, yeah, that's a good point. thank you. Yeah. How are we all doing tonight emotionally? Thanks for asking, Danny. I think there's just a lot of unknowns. I feel we as a team, first of all, I feel very fortunate to work with all of the teachers you saw present tonight. This fifth grade team is like none other, and our communication with one another, I think, keeps us feeling safe and supported. I know that I can go to anybody on the team if I need anything. And I think we're also like really prepared for like on the school side of it for whatever might happen this school year. We've had a lot of those conversations. We've done a lot of that planning, and I think we've laid the groundwork the last full week of school that we've been in. So like that kind of like is settling to just feel that preparedness. If anyone else wants to weigh in.
Guys, is there a chat? My thing is missing a chat option.
Oh, well, it's okay. If you don't have the chat, feel free to ask any questions.
So there's going to be 9 weeks of gym, and they don't have art until next year?
Yeah, I'll take that one. Correct. So they have rotations. So, and they're doing it that way to limit the cohorts who they're interacting with. So they're only interacting with me as the teacher at the time. And because I'm PE that way, I'm not interacting with grade one and then going to grade five and then going to grade three. So that rotation was purposely designed for that.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'll just add that the arts team has been really proactive in sharing resources for us that will help us integrate art and music into our curricula. So for example, I've talked to Josh. Last year he did a unit with the fifth graders around endangered or like ocean animal raps, and I do a unit on ocean animals. And so even though whether or not it lines up with the time that they have music, like I'm going to try to incorporate some of the work he's done in the past. I'm constantly in communication with Gilly. She's my Gibouche partner. So like anywhere there's a place to bring in some of the concepts that, you know, are important for fifth grade music and art, we're all in communication with each other very heavily. And I just will sort of piggyback on that to say, there's a lot that's different this year, and there's a lot that is like, whew, you know, it's like, we come home exhausted and it's a lot to take in. But I'm personally, and I'll just speak for myself here, but I'm personally energized by some of the changes I've already seen. I think that with any crisis comes an opportunity, and what this crisis has brought us is an opportunity to shift our practices and even like sort of look deeply at systems within the school that, you know, needed to change to meet this circumstance. But I'm finding that they kind of hit other goals in ways that we hadn't expected. And like, I'm, you know, it's for like collaboration among the teachers and different things like that. I think there's a lot of growth and possibility in our circumstances.
Okay, if anybody thinks of something that maybe wasn't addressed later tonight or, you know, tomorrow, and in the coming weeks, you know, please feel free to reach out to your child's advisor so that we can be of support and help out. You can also reach out if it's a specific content area question. Please also feel free to reach out to any one of us in regards to the content that we teach. So, you know, we really appreciate, again, you taking the time to listen to our spiel, and hopefully you have a really great, clear picture of what we do in fifth grade. And, you know, we look forward to continuing to teach your kids throughout the year. We're really excited. You know, like Deanna said, we, even though it is a little bit different and exhausting, it does feel energizing. And I think we're all feel fortunate to be here, you know, at school live with our kids. So thank you all. We really appreciate it. And we will hopefully see you again soon, maybe. I don't know.
Take care. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
We got a nice group of teachers.